Hello and welcome to Movie of the Year 1973. We are the only podcast on the internet with the science and the screaming to determine what is the best movie for any given year or what is the best playlist for any given year. We have been making a playlist so far, and I think it's going pretty well. The way we do it is we make it live in real time, and you follow along as we move the songs around, except for the first and last songs, which are set forever. And when we use a song, that artist is barred from being put on it again, which keeps us from just having Taylor do Steely Dan for every single song.
You know I fucking would, too.
Yeah, dude, I know you would. I absolutely know you would. Anytime we know that there's a way to be a little song goblin, you're going to go for it.
I came with multiple Steely Dan picks in case that you guys invented a new rule where you could veto one of my picks.
Do Steely Dan. Did you guys invent a new rule where you do Steely Dan nonstop? T-Money, let's give the listeners a sample of what the playlist is at so far.
Absolutely. So first of all, we're kicking it off with the best song on the playlist so far. Steely Dan's reeling in the years.
And that's locked. That's not going anywhere,
that's
folks.
Locked. No well, one can do anything to that.
The fact that it's the best song is not locked. But no. In its first position is locked.
Yeah, and the fact that it's the best song, because no one's going to beat that. Then that's going to be followed up by I Can't Stop This Feeling, a.k.a. Ooga Chaka by Blue Suede. Then we've got Crocodile Rock by Elton John. Right into Radar Love by the absolute multi-hit wonder Golden Earring. Then we've got Superfly by Curtis Mayfield. Midnight Train to Georgia by Gladys Knight and her pips. Killing Me Softly by Roberta Flack. And Marvin Gaye's Let's Get It On is currently sitting in our pole position. That's not what pole position means. What's the opposite of pole position?
In the rear with the gear?
It's in the rear. It's bringing up the caboose, but it will not be our ultimate caboose because that pick will go to Ryan at the end of this playlist.
Can we be honest right now with each other? It's okay. Been a month since we've been in the studio.
Yes.
How are you guys, by the way?
I'm
busy month.
Yeah. I'm doing okay. I came down with several different very bad diseases.
Did they cancel each other out?
Only two of them did, and then the rest really made each other stronger, sort of an iron sharpens iron situation.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Sort of get into the Psalms 23 of it all. But
for me, I made a big metal wall. Mm. It's like my ground. I move on there very fast.
That's now our podcast is dated. Now everyone knows exactly when we recorded this. If we're being honest, is there any song that anybody hates?
No, for me, no. These are all great songs.
That will happen tonight, I think. 73 is not a great year, so there's just some annoying music. But so far, so good.
The closest I have is Radar Love, just because I don't know it that
well. I would say there are three songs that absolutely, from 73, that annoy me so much that I like can't keep it in. And we talked at the beginning of last episode about Tie a Yellow Ribbon, Run the Old Oak Tree, because I just didn't think there was any chance anyone was going to select it. But there's two more doozies that if you choose them, Greg will scream and yell.
I think I know one.
I hope that I pick it.
I think one was mentioned last month.
Yeah.
I do. I think that
there's one I'm a huge piss baby about. For sure, dude.
I think Elton John's really good at a particular instrument. I think that other men might be.
Yep.
So if you're into that.
We will see. But you know what? I want to just jump right into it. I want to get right into it and make it happen. I forget who went last time.
It is my turn.
Okay, Ryan, take us away.
And I am going to go after Marvin Gaye. The whole one song per artist thing is really freaking me out right now. This could have my next song could have made a good closer.
Are you trying to do another Golden Earring song? We already have Radar Love up there, bud.
But I just wanted to jump on this guy as soon as possible.
What a great time for the Waka Chakas.
This is Stevie Wonder's Higher Ground. People, keep on learning. Can I show you guys this real quick?
Dude, show it.
Do you know who this is?
Is that Fleet?
I'll give you a hint. It's on the Beavis and Butthead Do America soundtrack. Because of when I was born, Stevie Wonder was introduced to me by the Red Hot Chili Peppers, who do an actually pretty good cover of this song. But so much Stevie Wonder in this
era. It's really fun to me that I can pick out Flea's bass. By sound. Like I know.
Kind of the way he plays, right?
Yeah, I'm like, oh no, that's Flea on bass, right? Like, I can't tell you any other part of it, but I'm like, yeah, it's Flea.
Do you know why? Feet. It's his left hand and his right foot, and that's how you can tell he's playing.
I feel like he, like, stays on the notes longer or something. I don't know. Yeah, there is definitely a quality that you feel like. Well, we are in Southern California right now. Some of us are actually from Southern California. So you hear Flea play.
I'm getting a Sublime logo tattooed on my arm right now during this recording. So there's a lot of that kind of music around here.
Stevie Wonder absolutely packed this time with incredible music.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong, Greg, but I do, since I am the king of the closer, I could just keep, like, I have Stevie Wonder locked down, but I can just move that to the end at the end, right?
Is that true?
I don't know. Do I have to announce the closer as the closer?
I feel like that's always the way we've done it.
Okay.
Well, yeah, because you know what it is? Like, we want the drama of here comes the closer, and I think we attenuate that drama if it's like, and it's that song you heard before.
When Kira Sedgwick's in, you're going to know it because she's the closer.
Exactly.
We all remember that, right?
We hear her music, and the bullpen door opens, and she comes running out. All right, so Taylor, wrapping back around to you, where would you like to go?
Well, so there's a song that I think has to be on this fucking playlist, but I don't know where to put it currently because it doesn't quite sound like anything else that's on there right now. So I'm going to put it after Stevie Wonder and just see what fucking happens, because I think I'm about to fuck all this shit up. So I'm going to put in Dolly Parton's Jolene.
Yeah.
Right here after Marvin Gaye or Stevie Wonder.
This is a tough nut to crack. Has to be on the thing.
Jolene, 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 I'm begging of you, please don't take my man. Jolene, 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 please don't take him just for
you guys know that she wrote Jolene and I Will Always Love You on the same day. And at the end of that day, she thought, man, people will tell this fucking same story for the rest of my life.
You're going to have to say that.
Do that forever. All the time. I considered putting this in the horny zone just because, like, it's like tangentially horny.
It's a pretty horny song. No, it really is. Like, the idea that you could have my man anytime you want.
Yeah.
And I'm begging you not to.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's a lot going on.
That's fine.
Yeah. There's like certain communities are going to be really into this part of it.
And we should also mention Dolly Parton, maybe the greatest human being to ever live. She goes on to guarantee that Jolene's kids will be able to read by providing them with books from the time they're very young. Yeah. So that's incredible.
What, donated like $1 million to solve Jolene's kids, like give them vaccinations and stuff?
She is the best person alive. And if she heard you say that, she'd be like, nah.
Yeah. Oh, sugar.
All right. Let's see. So it's coming to me, and I kind of want to do something a little weird.
Fuck it up, man. We're getting close to the end.
Which is, I noticed in the 70s, it became obvious that a lot of white artists, even I think this is the time in which it's becoming the most obvious that white artists are literally just listening to black music and then being like, oh, right, sounds pretty good.
So like it's always been the case, but now they're like, they're not covering it up.
Yeah, kind of. Like Paul Simon is like literally just like going to black churches and recording things and then like running back to his studio.
Just holding up his phone, like Big Red from Bring It On.
And a band that kind of always did that, but I feel like I could hear it so clearly when you played that Higher Ground by Stevie Wonder. I'm going to go with Money by Pink Floyd, and I'm going to put it right after Higher Ground by Stevie Wonder, and I wonder if people are going to hear it in the same way that I heard it.
Well, we got about 10 minutes of fucking Money noise.
I forgot that it did this, but it comes in pretty quick.
Now, Taylor, is this Flea?
This is not Flea.
Okay.
I do have a fun fact about this song.
Dolly Parton write it on that day?
Yeah, Dolly Parton wrote it on. This is the most commercially successful song ever written in a 7/4 time signature.
Okay.
That is an actual fact.
Shouldn't it be 7/3?
I think it's 7/4 because it's the quarter note.
But we're doing 19/7/3?
Oh, you're right.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no. Yeah, you're right.
No, let me change that.
Because of the year. How stupid of me.
No, yeah. Ryan was questioning your time signature.
I thought we were legitimately about to get into a music theory discussion on this podcast. Could you imagine?
Guys, I think that there's, and for a lot of the same reason, there's a band that I'm as confused and annoyed by more than Steely Dan.
Is it Pink Floyd?
Yeah.
Okay, why? Share.
Because you don't know who Pink is?
Yeah. Who
which,
is that
Which
guy?
One's Pink?
Which one's Pink?
Right?
I don't know, man. It just, I think it just passed me by. Like, you gotta just jump on the train or you're not on it.
Have you ever tried watching it with The Wizard of Oz?
I watched it with The Wizard of Oz, which was a skiing blooper reel that was on VHS when I was a kid.
I heard Wish You Were Here, which is, yeah, this is not off of, but I heard Wish You Were Here when I was going through a breakup when I was like 20 years old.
Yep.
And Pink Floyd became totally grafted to my soul, which is a shame that Roger Waters or whatever has become such a big shithead, yeah, but he's become like a pretty big shithead. But cool band. This is actually, yeah, this is probably my least favorite Pink Floyd song, but it's the most 73. I don't, yeah, Dark Side of the Moon's not my favorite Pink Floyd album. Money's not my favorite Pink Floyd song, but it is as 73 as it could possibly
be. I mean, like, honestly, I think that Taylor might have done this too. Not to speak for Taylor, but like, there's probably a million songs off of Can't Buy Me a Thrill, but Reeling in the Years is like the most, yeah, iconic. So yeah, you got to go with that.
I could have gone with a Dirty Work. I could have gone with, you know, I could have gone with anything. I could have gone with My Old School,
uh-huh,
off of Countdown to Ecstasy. I, there's any number.
You
of
could
things.
Just be making stuff up and right now. Just like nodding, sure, as you talk.
And so much of this album is, you know, 14 minute. You can't put it on a mixtape. So
yeah,
this is,
yeah,
like,
exactly,
this is like a classic single ish.
Yeah, they wrote this song for the radio. The levels of irony that it is so commercially successful,
yeah,
and is called Money, and then the whole thing is like Pink Floyd is this protest band,
yeah,
and they're like, they've made so much money that now he is like a bourgeois decadent, like,
yeah.
All right, Ryan, we are moving on to you, and things are getting serious, Ryan.
No, this is getting like, it's, I don't know, stressful.
We're going into like the fourth quarter now, basically.
I've been talking to my lawyers about what's been happening so far tonight. I think I'm going to go after, Stevie Wonder, and in between Stevie Wonder and Pink Floyd. Earlier I had said that I knew about Blue Suede's Ooga Chaka Ooga Chaka, and it wasn't because of Guardians. This one I did know because of a movie, but it came out in this year, or it was popular in this year, so let's do it. This is Kool and the Gang's Jungle Boogie. Driving home with my wife last night after seeing Asteroid City.
Yes.
And talking about how much, whether we wanted to or not, it happened. Wes Anderson and Quentin Tarantino just like curated the music that we
like. Yeah. It's interesting. I'm reading this book that you recommended to me, Peter
Biskin.
Biskin's Easy Riders and
Raging Bulls.
And he talks about the way that like one of the innovations of the late 60s, early 70s was like this marrying of film to music in like a, not just a soundtrack way, but like in a, make a little bit of a music video. And like you see it in Mean Streets. Like,
yeah, from 1973?
Yes, oh yeah, Mean Streets from 1973, yeah. Which we have either talked about or not talked
loved
about.
Loved it or didn't.
Yeah, yeah. We had feelings about it. But yeah, so you see that at the marrying of the two
it's,
forms.
It's so
like
crazy
that
what seems so obvious now,
yes,
had to be thought of,
yes,
at some point because it wasn't obvious. So Martin Scorsese was like, rock music.
Yeah.
Movies? Should I even do it?
And it's funny because then the way that film gets presented to us as 80s, 90s kids is it's already baked into the process. And so then when someone tells you, like, that was my idea, you're like, well, that's pretty obvious. But it's like, no, that was given to you.
Right. And then this is sort of this weird other thing with both Wes and QT, which is, you know, this Pulp Fiction doesn't take place in 73. It's just that I'm trying to give you a vibe that's,
yes,
a little bit 73.
Yes.
And so here we go with Pulp Fiction. Here with Jungle Boogie, like the opening credit song,
yeah,
after Miserloo.
All right, very good. So, Ryan, that was your Jungle Boogie going between Higher Ground and Money. That's a nice little nugget. That's a nice little part of the the playlist there. I almost said Nugget, and then I was like, well, I don't want to say that. That doesn't sound good. But you have to remember now, the Nuggets are champions, Ryan.
That is
so
true.
So that they put some respect on the name Nugget. As a sports fan, you lose sight of the fact that that is the most absurd name for a team.
It
really
is.
And then you sometimes say it in front of a non-sports fan, and they look at you like, what?
I'm sorry? Excuse me?
What are you talking about?
Who now?
What is that? Is that like a child's food item? What are you talking about? T-Money, since you've got your face screwed into that face, why don't you take us to the next place?
Okay. Here's what I'm gonna throw down into here. Because we're coming down into it, and I think now my goal is to just keep, like we said earlier, like I was trying to like play defense against your fuck ups. Mm-hmm. Now I'm trying to like fourth quarter just spike it right down, and just fuck up the whole vibe. But I'm going to go in between Stevie Wonder and Kool & the Gang, and I'm gonna do something from Bob Marley and the Wailers, and it's going to be Get Up, Stand Up.
Okay, man. This was a tough one, right? Where you're going to go this way or I Shot the Sheriff?
Yeah, and I think this is the way to go.
Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up.
Did the Wailers, much like the Pips, wear the same outfit and do little choreographed dances behind him?
I think they wore similar hats. Very vibey, slow, kind of nice rockin' sound.
Now, Taylor, let me ask you, is this something that the 73 mixtape must have? Like, or is this something that you actually love?
This is something that I actually love. Like I'll put it this way. I love it enough that it comes up on my Spotify randomized mixed playlists without me like really trying to find it. Like it's something that I do really enjoy. It's got a good vibe to it. And I feel like 73, you sort of have to like throw this. Like I think this is in the mix, but that wasn't maybe this wasn't maybe top of the charts, but like
It would be weird if we didn't include.
It would be very weird. Like there's a reason that this became like later the most popular like sort of poster you could imagine. Like it's
the Big Lebowski of its time.
It's the Big Lebowski of its time, and as we discussed, like you know, it's hard to choose like which song to put on here, but I just felt like. This is the one. Like I have a good vibe to this. It's got I think it's different enough from everything else that we have on the playlist. Like rhythm wise and instrumentality wise, I'm just having a good time with it.
As am I, and I have to do something that I feel like is a little like I don't know. I'm not trying to be an iconoclast here, and that'll be clear.
You get spicy with it.
Yeah, are you trying to put mixtapes on their head?
But. There is just a song that I cannot believe is from 1973, and it like recontextualizes time for me in a weird way. And maybe this won't be confusing to anybody else, but it's odd to me. And I'm going to put it after Jolene, so going towards the last part of our playlist. It is Dream On by Aerosmith. I don't think of Aerosmith as being contemporary to any other band that is on this playlist.
It's so crazy.
I'm a 90s kid. And
like,
they were
Alicia Silverstone was not in this video.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He sounds like a child. His voice is completely different. This is a 73 song. I can hardly believe it.
Truly blew my mind.
I didn't know this at the time because I was a kid, but that was their big comeback. Where like when I was introduced to them,
yes.
That was their big comeback.
Yes, and it was like, can you believe Aerosmith is back? And they're still pretty cool.
But I don't know if there's a song that showcases his vocals more than this. You know,
no.
Like he has to like you have to do some shit in this song.
Yeah,
and you know when they came back,
I wouldn't pick this at karaoke.
No, don't do that, dude.
No. Yeah, at the time, the vocal range that was popular for men was like so high, but you really have to be able to do that, otherwise it just sounds like garbage, and he can.
Yeah.
And then, you know, his voice matured and he kind of lost the ability to do this in the same way.
Yeah. In this era, you have to sing really high and talk about Gollum a lot. Like, that's just the vibe that they had.
Love a good Gollum jam. All right, Ryan, this is, I'm going to put you on notice. I think this is your last pick before your last pick.
Okay. That's what I wanted to know. So I've got a last pick in mind, but let's have a little bit of fun. And I would like to go, I think that I'm going to go second.
Oh, whoa! You're going right up near the tippy top almost.
This is Bruce Springsteen's Rosalita. This is Rosalia's Bizochito.
Oh God, I love her so much.
She's so good.
My
should
wife,
we call her?
Yeah.
Wait, do you have? Did you get the digits?
No.
Sorry. Oh, I
thought somebody else would.
My wife often asks me about my Bruce Springsteen love. She thinks it's because I'm an old white man, and that's not true. I'm young and
virile for sure.
Yeah. But. When he says the E Street Band, I really think it's like he went to a whole street called E Street and said, everyone who wants to be on stage right now, come on, horns, everything, let's just
Courtney
do this.
Cox, all of you.
Sometimes he's a little poetic, like, or almost like pseudo-poetic, and it gets like gravelly and annoying. But when he rocks out, I think he rocks out.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I think Rosalita is one of those songs.
Yeah. But Bruce Springsteen's so fucking good, you guys.
Yeah.
Is that like a common thought amongst people that are slightly younger than me?
I think so. I mean, I think that he is more popular with our parents' generation. We talked about this in the regular season, but 73, there was exactly two places in America. There was LA and New York. Like, there's no other place in the whole
country. And
why
would there be?
Yeah. And he is New York adjacent with New Jersey, but like, it brings that strong East Coast energy, and so...
Yeah, Bruce Springsteen is the only reason I think New Jersey should be allowed to continue existing.
But I just, I love the whole, like, everyone is jumping up and down. There's, like, 30 people in this band. That's always going to be a thing.
Yeah. And it's, like, every song is, like, triumphant in its sadness.
Uh-huh.
You know, just, like, it's all kind of, like, a grim. It's all a black parade, Ryan. That's really what it is.
I think that's such a good point. Like, I do think in a lot of ways he is the MCR of his generation. Of just, like, overdramatic, borderline Broadway.
Very narrative songs.
Very narrative songs. And then also having that 3-2-1 shh, bam, you know, like having those cue moments.
Bruce Springsteen is what Billy Joel wishes he was.
Oh shit.
Yeah, dude.
Greg, we're about
Fuck
to get out
Billy
of this episode
Fuck
without
off,
mentioning
Billy
his
Joel.
Name.
Oh my God. T-Money.
Yeah.
Where are you going next? Don't say Billy Joel.
I'm not going to. What if I did? What if
I know,
if I
dude.
Fucking did? No, here's where I'm going to go is I'm going to go in between Dolly Parton and Aerosmith. And what I'm going to choose is a song that has had a little bit of a resurgence on the TikTok recently. It's Free Bird by Skinner.
We've done it. This is a song I hate.
Yeah. This is, I wondered, it's hard to do 73 without Free Bird, but
it's not a 73 without it.
And yeah. I don't hate the song. I hate the people that like the song.
Yeah, which is me.
Like Taylor.
Yeah.
For instance.
Also, I feel like these guys are super racist. Is that correct?
I have no idea. You know, probably.
There's somebody like Lynn Nerd. That's such a hard R. I think that's racist.
I just think they're pro-South, and so that feels racist.
Yeah.
I'm Googling right now Lynyrd Skynyrd controversy. It's just, this song is like, as we were discussing, like, it's rock, but it's slow for most of it. You know, it's laid back. This is, I think 73 was the year of It's Summer All the Time.
Yes. Yeah.
I gotta say, like, that calm down from the... So I think that we did something different, the inverse of our normal mixtape, which is Fast, Slow, Fast.
Yeah.
We did Slow, Fast, Slow, because this come down of Money to Jolene to Freebird to Dream On, that is pretty good.
Yeah, I think that's setting us up nicely.
Not for my outro, but,
but for
somebody's outro.
For something.
That would have been great. All right, so then do I want to contribute to this? Yeah, you know what I do? Because I could slide right in there, and I think it'd be nice, even though you just said...
slide in.
slide on in. I'm going to go with 1973's Angie by the Rolling Stones. This is one of my favorite Rolling Stones songs. Very laid back, very chill. And I think I'm going to put it in between Freebird and Dream On.
Sophia.
73 is very much Rolling Stones, like, we're still here, bitches.
Yeah,
we
was just gonna ask
the Beatles.
Like, do you guys think in 1973 people were like, wow, when are they gonna retire? That's so crazy.
I like my favorite thing about the opening of this song is how he puts like four different vowel sounds on.
Hi,
it's like the pre-chorus of Zombie.
Without looking this up, I'm going to assume that this song is about a 14-year-old girl or something like
almost
that.
Sure.
So,
and like putting weird things in
apologies,
her, yeah.
Apologies for that.
Isn't she lovely?
It was a weird-ass time in the culture, and especially rock culture, where it was like, hey, maybe we could, and it's like, guys, don't. But
if you didn't.
With forward knowledge of the outro, I will say that like there's no... Dylan, there's no... So Rolling Stones is like a 60s band, but there's no Dylan, there's no Zeppelin, there's no... I feel like that we did kick a lot of those people out of this list.
Yeah, there easily could have been Zeppelin. The problem is... I think the problem is that there are two 73s, and we tried to marry them as much as we could, but the rock 73 versus the pop 73, those sensibilities, it's hard to combine them except in the limited ways that we did. But if you can go a whole rock way with 73 that I think is really different and points to different artists, but it leaves out too many of the sounds of 73, which we needed to include, like Jolene.
Jolene.
So, Ryan.
Yeah.
The moment has come. It is time for our outro song. What is it, my friend?
Greg, when I'm listening to music... When I'm listening to you talk, what do I want? I want you to get to the taking care of business part.
Hell yeah. Is that from The Simpsons where the crowd demands they sing the song and then demands they get to the taking care?
That is. Also, going back to High Fidelity, Jack Black's band was formerly known as Kathleen Turner Overdrive. This is Bachman Turner Overdrive.
It's probably kind of a garbage point to make, but I'm going to say also 73 and the years around it are a time where like we were as a culture, we were like capitalism, huh? And we were kind of like rubbing our chin and we were like, which way are we going to go? And this way points, we're going deeper into capitalism.
Yeah.
We're going to make sure that we are taking care of business.
Taking care of that business. There's
business. Working overtime. Yeah. You know, I don't even pay me for overtime. I want to do it because that's just what I do.
That's just I'm doing my part for the company, you know?
Yeah.
They've treated me so well.
Extra money, cut my paycheck in half when I'm in overtime.
Cut my paycheck to pieces. This is my favorite job. All right. Well, unfortunately that song won't make it, but all the other ones will. So we're gonna go round robin, starting with me, then Ryan, then Taylor. The first song is Steely Dan's Reelin'.
Next up is Rosalita by Bruce Springsteen and the E Street Band.
Then we've got I Can't Stop This Feeling, a.k.a. Ooga Chaka Ooga Chaka by Blue Suede.
Crocodile Rock by Elton John.
Manfred Mann's Earth Band did not make it, but you know who did? Golden Earrings, Radar Love.
Then we've got Curtis Mayfield's Superfly from the titular Superfly.
Gonna take that midnight train to Georgia with Gladys Knight. And if there's room, the Pips.
Are you killing me hard? Roberta Flack says no. You're killing me softly by Roberta Flack.
You're not getting off that easy. It's Let's Get It On by Marvin Gaye.
What is the it he's talking about? Feeling low? Why not get to some higher ground with Stevie Wonder?
Get Down, Stand Down by the Non-Wailers? No. It's Get Up, Stand Up by the Wailers.
No clever pun here. Jungle Boogie by Kool & the Gang.
Money by Pink Floyd.
And then it's finally Dolly Parton's same song that she wrote in the same day with I Will Always Love You. It's Jolene.
Not finally. It's Freebird by Lynyrd Skynyrd.
Angie by the Rolling Stones.
That is Aerosmith's Dream On, Dream On.
Then, closing it out, we are Taking Care of That Business by Bachman Turner, Overdrive.
Gentlemen, I'm going to say it. This was a tough thing to have to do, and we did it perfectly.
It's perfect. You can't give us any notes, and if you try, I will murder you.
If Moses came down from that fucking mountain with something lightning onto a big cement tablet, and it said 1973 mixtape, this is what God lightninged down.
He would say, let my people go to the record store and play all of these in this order.
Let my people groove. And with that, we are done. We will be back next week with another scintillating show. But until then, keep listening to them albums.